Good morning, dear friends and participants of the marathon. I understand that at least we have the marathon of a global scale. It's called Spiritual Victory, the victory of the spirit over the matter. We are guaranteed such victory at the end of the marathon. I congratulate everyone with this important event. We begin today, and right away we have an adventure. Marathon is an adventure, and an adventure is Krishna. And the sign of Krishna's presence here, there is spontaneity and unpredictability. And it started with the fact that the devotees are waiting for me, a lecture on Srimad Bhagavatam, but Valmiki Prabhu, the main leader of this marathon, has asked me yesterday already to start discussing Bhagavad Gita, the first chapter, from text 20 until the end of the chapter 1. And one way or another, we will be able to combine this contradiction and we'll come out victorious and successful. And in this connection, I will read the commentary to Srimad Bhagavatam. It will be a certain blessing by Srila Prabhupada. This commentary is so exactly describing the great meaning of this marathon that is ahead of us, when Srila Prabhupada is giving his magnanimous blessing to all that study Srimad Bhagavatam. Symbolically, this commentary that I will read is the last instruction of Srila Prabhupada in this world. We understand that at the end of this, the path of a great soul, we'll talk about the most important things and we'll give the most important instructions. And Srila Prabhupada dictated this commentary that I will read now. He dictated it a few days before he left this world. This commentary is to the chapter 12 of Canto 10. We know that Srila Prabhupada has translated 13 chapters of Canto 10, and so these are the last words of Srila Prabhupada. It's the greatest instruction. It's very important to all of us. So it's Srimad Bhagavatam, Canto 10, chapter 12, the killing of the demon Kasura. The text 11, the commentary to text 11, Srila Prabhupada says, if we are indifferent to Bhagavad Gita, Srimad Bhagavatam, it's not known how our next theme will be in the science of Krishna consciousness. But those who adhere to these two greatest books of Srimad Bhagavatam and Bhagavad Gita, in the next life, are guaranteed the opportunity to communicate with Krishna, to see Krishna, and Prabhupada refers to Bhagavad Gita. We will see Krishna if we all our life till the end of our life will adhere and will adhere to these two books, Srimad Bhagavatam and Bhagavad Gita, and those who distribute Srimad Bhagavatam through the whole world give a great benefit to theosophists, to theologists, to scientists, to yoginam, to ordinary people. If one way or another we remember Krishna Narayana at the end of our path, this is the message to all people of this planet, to this world scale marathon. This is a great instruction, and I congratulate all of you, all of us, with this wonderful grace bestowed upon us to participate in this wonderful event. So harmoniously, we transition to Bhagavad Gita with this great commentary and instruction from Srila Prabhupada. And Bhagavad Gita starts from the description of Leela. of Krishna's lila. When he came here about 5,000 years ago, at the culmination of his games, his lilas, it's the battle of Kurukshetra, where, how it happens in this world, two beginnings, two sources, the demonical and the divine, the divine is full of pure devotion, pure love, and it's a symbolically describing, symbolically described this clash between these two beginnings of demonical and divine. It's the clash of two dynasties, but actually it's one dynasty. It's the Kuru dynasty, and which sees the split. We will not be able to describe in great detail the plot of this great lila, great crisis, what we see in Mahabharata being described. It's a very detailed description of how a demonical beginning through ill-minded Duryodhana, who came from the lower planets, especially to this world, to strengthen the demonical beginning, the demonical source. It's very, in great detail, described in Mahabharata, how in the face of Duryodhana, how he strengthened the demonical source, and how by the doubts and the shaking of other members of his dynasty, also gave in to this demonical beginning, demonical source, and how Pandavas, the devotional members of this dynasty, how they found shelter at the lotus feet of Supreme Personality of Godhead, and by the fact of their pure devotion, which is very alien to the material nature, it's an eternal collision and eternal conflict between the devotees and non-devotees, and how devotees always come out victorious. And Prabhupada helps us in his commentaries how to help the devotees in this Kali Yuga, that the devotees are being depressed by the Kali Yuga and by the material nature. How a devotee can obtain this spiritual victory. So for that you need a certain science, and Srila Prabhupada inspires us in a certain way that it's not enough to just be devoted, but you need to learn the science and the process of how to be devoted. And the essence of this process of pure devotion is described in this lila of how a pure devotee of Krishna, the greatest devotee of Krishna, how he enters this lila, especially rolled out for the benefit of all living beings, living entities, how he falls down from the level of pure devotion, and how he is devastated, falling down, and how he goes through transformation and comes down, resurrecting his pure devotion. He resurrects his relationship with the Supreme Personality of Godhead. And in this first chapter, it talks about how Arjuna comes down from the path of pure devotion. It's understandable that Arjuna is an eternal friend of Krishna. Krishna and Arjuna are connected by eternal and transcendental friendship, and it's not possible that Arjuna gets down from this pure devotion path, but to the according to the Lila Shakti, how he comes out, how comes down from the pure devotion, how this great devotee of Krishna comes, falls down from this pure devotion and then transforms and then comes back. But externally, this Lila was manifested and rolled out, so that how Arjuna is falling down under the influence of material nature and how he feels weakness, and how Krishna, it looks from out from the surface, that how he starts to doubt Krishna. But really, Arjuna is not an ordinary living being. It's not like you and I. He's not like you and I. But this Lila is rolled out for the benefit of us. So he falls down of under the force of Lila Shakti, of this Lila, and he will go through the tribulation of a soul. And in Bhagavad Gita, in great detail, we'll see how this transformation of a living being from this spiritual state, and how he's devastated, and how he gets transformed, and how he resurrects, the living being resurrects his initial spiritual nature. And the goal is very important to see. The goal of any living entity is to resurrect the spiritual, the connection with the spiritual Nitya Krishna, Nitya Siddha, Krishna Prema. The Lord Chaitanya, by whose mercy we understand this, we understand the Krishna Prema. We see that we are always connected, eternally connected with Krishna. And this is the goal of sadhana. And it's achieved through Shravana. What we're gonna do during all this marathon, through the listening about Krishna. The listening about Bhagavad Gita, we will resurrect the Krishna Prema. We have to get Krishna Prema in the focus as our goal. And if we set it as a goal, it will be attainable. So let's not forget that this marathon is done so that we resurrect our Krishna Prema, our initial nature of our soul, and with this attitude we begin. So Arjuna, under the influence of Lila Shakti, internal energy of Lila Shakti, he is in a relationship with Krishna. Krishna is his charioteer. All is like this. He sees, he feels his support of his devoted friend. And here, on this battle, we'll see the paradox. Text 20. Arjuna, the son of Pandu, seated in the chariot, bearing the flag marked with Hanuman, and Hanuman is the symbol of spiritual victory, is the sign that where Krishna, where the Lord Ramachandra, there the victory is. So Krishna and Arjuna enter the battle under the flag of Hanuman, the flag of spiritual victory. So he's ready to shoot his arrows. But after looking at the sons of Dhritarashtra, drawn in military array, Arjuna then speaks to Lord with such words, and they were strange. They were not corresponding with the spirit of eternal friendship of Krishna and Arjuna. So next text, Arjuna said, O Infallible One, please draw my chariot between the two armies so that I may see those present here who desire to fight and with whom I must contend in this great trial of arms. Let's see the commentary how Prabhupada will describe how Prabhupada describes why Arjuna needs something else in the relationship with Krishna. In the beginning, Prabhupada glorifies this rasa between Krishna and Arjuna. And out of his cosmic mercy, Krishna was engaged in the service of his friend Arjuna. For the affection of his devotees, he is always ready for everything, and it's the fact that Krishna is always ready to serve his devotees. So that's why he's addressed as infallible. As charioteer of Arjuna, he had to carry out the orders of Arjuna, and since he did not hesitate to do so, he's addressed as infallible. And although he had accepted the position of a charioteer for his devotee, his supreme position was not challenged in all circumstances. He is the supreme personality of Godhead, Rishikesha, the Lord of the total senses. The relationship between the Lord and his servitor is very sweet and transcendental. The servitor is always ready to render service to the Lord. And similarly, the Lord is always seeking an opportunity to render some service to the devotee. He takes greater pleasure in his pure devotees assuming the advantageous position of ordering him than he does in being the giver of orders. Here it's described that the Lord is taking more pleasure in serving his devotees than when devotee serves him. So it's the Lord is very pleased when his devotees, pure devotees, order him. We know that the children Leelas of Krishna are described, the childhood Leelas of Krishna in Vrindavan are described, how Krishna was so pleased to carry the shoes of his father on his head, and how with great pleasure he was so devoted to fulfill the wishes and the orders of gopis to sing a song or to dance. He loves to fulfill the wishes of his devotees. It's the highest meaning. And being the pure devotees of the Lord, Arjuna had no desire to fight with his cousins and brothers. He was forced to come onto the battlefield by the obstinacy of Duryodhana, who was never agreeable to any peaceful negotiation. Therefore, he was very anxious to see who the leading persons present on the battlefield were. Although there was no question of a peacemaking endeavor on the battlefield, he wanted to see them again and to see how much they were bent upon demanding of unwanted war. So Arjuna wants to see, he's starting to shake. He wants to see if Duryodhana's plans are still firm. So he wants to see how powerful the opponent is. Although in accordance to the Krishna consciousness, the transformation of consciousness of Arjuna, we see that it enters the gunas of material nature, and let's watch this transformation. Text 23, let me see those who have come here to fight, wishing to please the evil-minded son of Dhritarashtra. It was an open secret that Duryodhana wanted to usurp the kingdom of Pandavas by evil plans. And Prabhupada comments, in this text.
Of course,
he wanted to see also how powerful his opponent is, although he was not doubting his victory, but Arjuna wanted to see them on the battlefield, just to learn how they were. But he had no intention of proposing peace, but he is still connected with Krishna. But he's already counting on himself. And then in text 24, Sanjaya says, O descendant of Bharata, having thus been addressed by Arjuna, Lord Krishna drew up the fine chariot in the midst of the armies of both parties. So text 25, we'll not read all commentaries so that we go to the end of the chapter 1. Text 25, in the presence of Bhishma, Drona, all the chieftains of the world, the Lord said, just behold, Partha, all the Kurus assembled here. And Prabhupada gives a very important commentary. As the super soul of all living entities, Lord Krishna could understand what was going on in the mind of Arjuna. The use of the word Shikesha in this connection indicates that he knew everything, and the word Partha, or the son of Kunti, or Partha, is also similarly significant in reference to Arjuna. As a friend, the Lord Krishna wanted to inform Arjuna that because Arjuna was the son of Partha, the sister of his own father Vasudeva, he had agreed to be the charioteer of Arjuna. Now, what did Krishna mean when he told Arjuna to behold the Kurus? Did Arjuna want to stop there and not to fight? Krishna never expected such things from the son of his aunt Pritha. The mind of Arjuna was thus predicted by the Lord in friendly joking. So it was unexpected by Krishna. So Arjuna jokes. So Krishna never expected. I never expected such things from the son of his aunt. So the Lord predicts the change that will take place in the mood of Arjuna. Text 26. There Arjuna could see within the midst of the armies of both parties, his father, grandfathers, teachers, maternal uncles, brothers, sons, grandsons, friends, and also his fathers-in-law and well-wishers. So he sees all his relatives. And when the son of Kunti saw all his relatives, his son became full of empathy, so really depressed, he says. So compassion, empathy is the sign of pure devotion. But there we see that this compassion was in the midst of the guna of grace. So now Arjuna shows the examples of how this transformation and falling down, this gradual falling down from the spiritual state, coming down to the gunas of material nature. The guna of grace is still pure, but it's already projected to this material world, and all the natural qualities coming out of the liberated soul and reflected in the guna of grace and through the prism of false ego. The false ego means selfishness, focus on your own desires. Pritya and Atma, the soul, Ahankara makes the living entity, the Pritya, to get attached to their own feelings. and focus on your own. First element of transformation, the living entity is empathic according to its nature. It's a nature of the spiritual soul and of a living entity. But this Krishna Prema of Arjuna is manifested in Akmandriya Priti, is the ignorance of focus on his own, on his own, what's going to happen to me. So it is empathy and compassion to other people, but it has the context of personal benefit, is the false empathy, false compassion. So false compassion is very attractive in this world because we help other people in one way or another to go through suffering, but it manifests such that the soul is still in the confinement of material world. It's like in a jail conditions. And by jail, I mean the material world. And a living entity is like a jailman in the jail of material world, still rests and ends up in the jail of material world because of false empathy. But pure devotion and pure empathy liberates the soul. So the focus on his own, it's a sign of pure devotion, but the false compassion is the focus on his own needs. So text 28, Arjuna says, "My dear Krishna, seeing my friends and relatives present before me in such a fighting spirit, I feel the limbs of my body quivering and my mouth drying up." So you see that the false compassion is an eternal weakness. And by that, he breaks the eternal connection with eternal connection with Krishna. And Atmahag is the killing of a soul. And this pure devotion, a pure devotee is acting because of good intentions, but the focus on his own feelings. And Prabhupada comments, any man who has genuine devotion to the Lord has all the good qualities which are found in godly persons or in the demigods, whereas the non-devotees, however advanced he may be in material qualification by education and culture, lacks in godly qualities. As such, Arjuna, just after seeing his kinsmen, friends, and relatives on the battlefield, was at once overwhelmed by compassion for them who had so decided to fight amongst themselves. As far as his soldiers were concerned, he was sympathetic from the beginning, but he felt compassion even for the soldiers of the opposite party, foreseeing their imminent death. So, and while he was so thinking, the limbs of his body began to quiver, and his mouth became to dry. He was more or less astonished to see their fighting spirit. So the ignorance is sneaking into Arjuna's spirit. So practically the whole community, all blood relatives of Arjuna, had come to fight with him, thus overwhelmed a kind of devotee like Arjuna. And here we see the reason why a devotee is facing the difficulties to act in this material world. So exactly describes that it's such a such when a devotee when a devotee is experiencing this loss of yoga, this connection with the Lord. So the chapter is called the devotee, the Arjuna, like Arjuna, will maintain the connection, the eternal yoga with Krishna. Ontologically, he's connected with Krishna, but emotionally, he is not, and the rasa is lost. And that's why the gunas of material nature are manifested. The Lord is the devotee is not able to analyze this, to see this situation as a lila of Krishna, and to take this situation and use it in a service of Krishna as a lila, see it as a lila. It's not a tragedy. So the false devotion and false compassion, although it has some value, in fact, it diminishes the yoga with the Lord and takes out the force and the strength of this connection with the Lord. So by this immersion in sukha dukha, so under the influence of the false empathy, although it's good intention, he has pure heart. Yeah, Arjuna is a pure devotee, and all devotees empathize out of good intentions, but when they have true compassion, they will not fight against these people, but for the consciousness of these people. So they have psychological fallbacks and setbacks or shyness. So when a devotee is getting under the influence of material nature, he has difficulties. So Bhagavad Gita is helping the pure devotees to act in material world and achieve victory. So we continue. So the texts from 21 to 28, they show the transformation from this very insignificant but very small but very meaningful transformation. So this emotion of devastation. So from 29 to 46, it's another emotion of Arjuna when he starts analyzing, and he's arguing even by the quotations of sacred scriptures, and by the end of this chapter, Arjuna will say, "I will not be able to fight." So let's see this transformation. And Arjuna. Arjuna says, "My whole body is trembling. My hair is standing on end. My bow, Gandiva, is slipping from my hand, and my skin is burning." So Arjuna is getting into a trance, but not a spiritual trance. It's a trance of panic. It's because of ignorance that is entering his heart. So in the commentaries of Prabhupada, he says that the trembling of the limbs and trembling of the body is either for two reasons. Is either for the spiritual ecstasy or for the material nature. There are two kinds of trembling of the body, two kinds of standing of the hair on end. Such phenomena occur either in great spiritual ecstasy or out of great fear under material conditions. There is no fear in transcendental realization. Arjuna's symptoms in this situation are out of material fear, namely loss of life. This is evident from other symptoms also. He became so impatient that his famous bow, Gandiva, was slipping from his hands. So even on Vaikuntha, or the spiritual planet, where Krishna constantly talks and tells Arjuna Leelas, their eternal relationship, their spiritual Leela. Srila Prabhupada says that in this situation, Arjuna came under the influence of fear of loss of life and under the influence of material nature. This is evidence from other symptoms also. Arjuna was so impatient, so panicking, that his bow Gandiva was slipping from his hand. And because his heart was burning within him, he was feeling a burning sensation of the skin in his whole body. And all these are due to material conception of life. So, I'm now unable to stand here any longer, text 30. I'm forgetting myself and my mind is reeling. I see only causes of misfortune, O Krishna, healer of the Keshi demon. So, he's appealing to his friends, but not to get inspired to act experience further on this wonderful friendship, but actually to complain. So the friends in material world, if the friendship is based on material things, it's not to strengthen the spiritual consciousness, the consciousness of Krishna, but to complain about our husbands so that somebody shows us their support, to support our false ego, to increase our self-esteem, otherwise it will be a complete catastrophe. So why we need material friends? So Arjuna is getting into a false dependence on Krishna. And he says, Krishna, please understand me. I cannot. I do not have any energy. This is the first argument that makes Arjuna stop fighting, not to start fighting. So we are actually going to watch this path of falling down of Arjuna into the devastation. And Arjuna will put onto the table four arguments how he will base his desire to stop serving, to stop his pure devotional service. So these arguments are quite symbolical and very important, so we can diagnose in our own consciousness when we see some difficulties in the spiritual life. So on the level of Nishtha, you don't have any difficulties, but before Nishtha, you have such, and we should be experts to differentiate this joke of material nature. It starts from the good intentions, from empathy, from friendship, from love, but they come out of the spirit of selfishness and egotism, self-centeredness. So from text 29 on, and Arjuna says, Krishna, I cannot do it, my whole body is trembling. These are my relatives. So he says, like, I'm not unable to stand here. My memory is failing me. So, Prabhupada comments, due to his impatience, Arjuna was unable to stay on the battlefield, and he was forgetting himself on account of this weakness of his mind. Excessive attachment for the material things puts a man in such a bewildered condition of existence. So, such fearfulness and loss of mental equilibrium take place in persons who are too affected by material conditions. Arjuna envisioned only painful victory, only painful reverses in the battlefield. He would not be happy even by gaining victory over the foe. So in Bhagavad Gita 11.2.37, Chayam Dvitya Hinivesata Syat. So this through the emotion of fear. So the person is identified with the object of this material world. Man or woman has material qualities and material obligations, material duties, and they get infected with this fear, and they go mad in this battle of survival. So this fear is the antipode of bhakti. So the path of bhakti is forcing out this fear.
So,
and Prabhupada says that this fear, such fear, fearfulness or, and loss of material equilibrium take place in persons who are affected by material conditions. So these are the obstacles to spiritual
world.
Arjuna envisioned only painful reverses in the battlefield. He would not be happy even by gaining victory over the foe. These words, nimitani, viparitani, are significant. When a man sees only frustration in his expectations, he thinks, why am I here? Everyone is interested in himself and his own welfare. No one is interested in the Supreme Self. Arjuna is showing ignorance of his real self-interest by Krishna's will. One's real interest lies in Vishnu or Krishna. And Prabhupada says, as if Arjuna lost interest in Krishna, and as if Krishna. So, nimitani, viparitani, as if the Russian proverb, you had best intentions, but it happened as usual. So, the expectation in this world will always bring you to disappointment, even if everything comes out as you plan. This picture of happiness, even if in the ideal scenario, it will materialize. The person will come to a conclusion that it's not what he wanted. So, viparitani is actually expectations. So, nimitani is the cause and viparitani is the opposite. So it's illusory energy of the spiritual world, of this material world. So text 31, we go to the second, the mentality of material nature. I do not see, Arjuna says, how any good can come from killing my own kinsmen in this battle, nor can I, my dear Krishna, desire any subsequent victory, kingdom or happiness. So Arjuna is actually talking about his interests. It's concentration on himself. It's the egotism, the egocentrism that is breeding in from the very birth and from the very, very beginning of people's lives. So Arjuna is asking, which good am I going to receive? I'm not going to benefit from that, and I'm not going to be take pleasure from this if I will not be able to take pleasure in it. So it's a typical ahankara. No victory, no kingdom, no happiness. I don't need it at such price. So my feelings, the highest value, the highest virtue is my feelings. So this is the price of false compassion. But look, it's all under disguise of beautiful feelings. So Bhagavad Gita dismantles this lie. So Prabhupada says in his commentary, without knowing that one's self-interest is in Vishnu or Krishna, conditioned souls are attracted by bodily relationship, hoping to be happy in such situations. Arjuna appears to have even forgotten the causes of material happiness. Arjuna appears to have even forgotten the moral codes for Kshatriya, his karma. It is said that two kinds of men, namely the Kshatriyas, who die directly in front of the battlefield under Krishna's personal order, and the person in a renounced order of life who is absolutely devoted to spiritual culture are eligible to enter into the sun's globe, which is so powerful and dazzling. So Arjuna is reluctant even to kill his enemies, let alone his relatives. He thinks that by killing his kinsmen, there would be no happiness in his life, and therefore he is not willing to fight. Just as a person who does not feel hunger is not inclined. He has now decided to go into the forest and live a secluded life in frustration. But as a kshatriya, he requires a kingdom for his subsistence, because kshatriyas cannot engage themselves in any other occupation. But Arjuna has no kingdom. Arjuna's sole opportunity for gaining kingdom lies in fighting with his cousins and brothers and reclaiming the kingdom inherited from his father, which he does not like to do. Therefore, he considers himself fit to go to the forest to live a secluded life of frustration. So Prabhupada hints that even in material sense, Arjuna is not a brahmana, he's not made for secluded life. He is kshatriya, he has to fight. So not only his spiritual life is getting destroyed, but his material life also. So Prabhupada explains how, on the example of Arjuna, a living being is losing his spiritual qualification because of ignorance, breaks the laws even of material world, and preparing a tragedy for himself, because spiritual world doesn't forgive the breaking of material laws. So further on, O Govinda, of what avail to us our kingdom, happiness, or than life itself, when all those for whom we may desire them are now arrayed on this battlefield? He feels the threat to his being. O Madhusudana, when teachers, fathers, sons, godfathers, maternal uncles, fathers-in-law, grandsons, brothers-in-law, or other relatives are ready to give up their lives and properties and are standing before me, why should I wish to kill them, even though they might or otherwise kill me, or maintainer of all living entities? I'm not prepared to fight with them, even in exchange for the free will, let alone this earth. I don't want to be a bad person. I want to be a good, but it's not The soul that's speaking, it's Ahankara that's speaking. I want to be a good prisoner in a jail. I want to be in a, I'm each jailman, each criminal sincerely believes that they are in a jail by mistake. But mistakes in the laws of the Lord, they could not occur. So we have done such crime, but we cry, we say that I'm a good man, I'm not a criminal, but it's an illusion. But Arjuna already committed a crime. He broke the connection with Krishna. He doesn't really understand anything. He lost his consciousness. So all these arguments show that his consciousness is already material. And it comes out of material nature. What pleasure will we derive from killing the sons of Dhritarashtra? Yeah, of course, no pleasure. But the point is not in the pleasure. The pleasure should be experienced by Krishna. So let's go to text 36. The third argument, the sin will overcome us if we stay such aggressive. Therefore, it is not proper for us to kill the sons of the Dhritarashtra and our friends.
So,
it's the code of Vedic scriptures. So, we see as castigation a jail. But from the material, world, if we commit violence, we will suffer. But in consciousness of Krishna, there is no sin. If he was staying in the rasa, in the relationship to Krishna, based on spiritual relations with Krishna, cannot be sinful, because it's connected with the interests of the Lord. It's the manifestation of the Lord's will. It's not sinful, even if Krishna heals somebody, he saves that living entity from the jail of material nature. He killed so many demons, but all of the demons that were killed by Krishna, they got received the liberation. But Arjuna is not able to understand all of that. And he is projecting all of these things on himself. And he doesn't understand. And in the consciousness that he is right now, in the material consciousness, he knows that he understands that he's going to be punished because he lost the connection with the Lord. He lost the most important thing. And we will suffer because we will see reactions. So we see that we do not have time to read the nectar commentary of Srila Prabhupada. So we should go on. So the last argument based on the social context. So if we show the example of sinful person that is not showing empathy. So when we are on the platform of material consciousness, we will suffer. And he's right. But based on spiritual platform, it's not right. But from a material point of view, his material nature is right. O Janardana, although these men, they are hearts overtaken by greed, see no fault in killing one's family or quarreling with friends. Why should we, who can see the crime in destroying a family, engage in this act of sin. So he says, Krishna, what are you pushing me to? So the material consciousness, it's an argument. So the destruction of somebody's dynasty, the eternal family tradition is vanquished, and thus the rest of the family becomes involved in the religion. So we should not, this social system of institutions, Varnashrama institutions, there are many principles of religion, traditions to help members of the family grow properly and attain spiritual value. So, if we keep the family traditions but we don't have Krishna consciousness, it will destroy the family and destroy the society. So we should be attentive, we should be careful. If we're not in Krishna consciousness, the argument of Arjuna touches immediately, but it's the result of falling down of Arjuna from the Krishna consciousness. And Prabhupada says here that the system of Varnashrama institution, there are many principles of religion traditions to help members of the family grow properly and attain spiritual values. And this is the strength of his argument. But from the spiritual platform, he's not right. So he says the truth, but not
fully.
So the strength of the spiritual lie is even more cunning than the material lie,
material illusion.
Because material lie is based on the truth that is not fully expressed. So partial truth is masqueraded as a truth. But the leading entity is seeing a truth. But 1% of lie in the material truth makes it a lie and makes it a dangerous lie. So Arjuna, even from a spiritual standpoint, is a selfish, because he's a very cunning, very powerful lie, with 99% of the truth, but 1% of lie.
So,
next text is when irreligion is prominent in the family, O Krishna, the women of the family become polluted, and from the degradation of womanhood, the descendant of Vrishni comes unwanted progeny. Good population in human society is the basic principle for peace, prosperity, and spiritual progress in life. So, the Varnashrama's religion principle was so designed that the good population would prevail in society for the general spiritual progress of state and community. But if the spiritual platform is lost, then after leaving this world, the people, the soul will be suffering from the irreligion. So, according to Chanakya Pandita, women are generally not very intelligent and therefore not transformed. So, on the failure of such Varnashrama Dharma, naturally the women become free to act and mix with men. An increase of unwanted population certainly causes hellish life, both for the family and for those who destroy the family tradition, in text 41. and the ancestors of such corrupt families fall down because the performances for offering them food and water are entirely stopped. So, and then further on in text 42, by the evil deeds of those who destroy the family tradition and thus give rise to unwanted children, all kinds of commonly projects and family welfare activities are devastated. The result of sinful progeny. In text 43, Arjuna says, O Krishna, maintainer of the people, I have heard by disciplic succession that those whose family traditions are destroyed dwell always in hell. It's the truth that Arjuna bases his arguments not on his own personal experience, but on what he has heard from the authorities. This is the way of receiving real knowledge. One cannot reach the real point of factual knowledge without being helped by the right person who is already established in that knowledge. And Prabhupada talks about the system of Varnashrama institution and also disciplic succession. It's very important to have the faith and belief in the seniors and in the masters and in disciple succession. And the master, the spiritual master, is the system of people who are already established in that knowledge of a foundation of the knowledge being the truthful one. One who's always engaged in sinful activities might utilize the process of atonement called prayaschita. Without doing so, one surely will be transferred to hellish planets to undergo miserable lives. So, alas, how strange is it? It is that we are preparing to commit greatly sinful acts. Driven by the desire to enjoy royal happiness, we are intent on killing our own kinsmen. In text 44, Arjuna says, and commentary of Srila Prabhupada, driven by selfish motives, one may be inclined to such sinful acts as the killing of one's own brother. So Arjuna concludes the last argument. So the first argument is empathy. The second one is benefit. Third, he understands that it's a sin being committed and you have to suffer for that. And the fourth is a bad example for the people that are surround you. So for the rest, better for me if the sons of the Dharashtra, weapons in hand, were to kill me unarmed and unresisting. So Sanjaya says in text 44, Arjuna, having thus spoken the battlefield, cast aside his bow and arrows and sat down in the chariot, his mind overwhelmed. Prabhupada in his commentary says, while observing the situation of his enemy, Arjuna stood up on the chariot, but he was so afflicted with lamentation that he sat down again, setting aside his bow and arrows. Such a kind and soft-hearted person in the devotional service of the Lord is fit to receive self-knowledge. So it's the exit from the rasa, and he's falling down from the spiritual platform and going down to the material platform, and that's the result. He is really worn down, he is wiped out, and thus end the Bhaktivedanta reports in the first chapter of the Srimad Bhagavad Gita in the matter of observing the armies on the battlefield of Kurukshetra. And the rest of Bhagavad Gita is full of transcendental knowledge. And if he listens to Bhagavad Gita, we will resurrect our spiritual connection with the spiritual platform and with the the Lord, and I really congratulate all of you and congratulate you with the participation in the marathon. And I would like to now answer a few questions.
Изобилуют тем трансцендентным знанием, которое полностью установлено в сознании Кришны Арджуны. Если мы слушаем Бхагавад-гиту, это полностью восстановит также наше с вами сознание Кришны. И что это значит?
Why Arjuna is not listed in the disciple succession? Krishna was his master. I will try to explain from the rasas of true relationships.
Although with the Lord. Although,
we
know a lot of elevated few devotees, who, those who are in the parampara of
disciples, they have this. У нас вопрос от Елены. Подскажите, пожалуйста, почему Арджуна не перечислен в цепи ученической преемственности? Кришна же был его духовным учителем.
According to the special rasa.
Я попытаюсь объяснить это с точки зрения расы татвы или истинных взаимоотношений. Несмотря на то, что мы
other service to Krishna, they do not have to fulfill the parampara, their role in the parampara. They are considered pure devotees. The parampara system we see is based on the tradition, on the tradition of authorized by Krishna, the pure devotees authorized by Krishna, that they are preaching the eternal Sanatana Dharma. And Arjuna showed a different example. He wasn't an example of Acharya, of example of preaching. He was preaching pure devoted service as Kshatriya, as his act of a warrior. So, the Guru Parampara is made of preachers, of Brahmanas, of the ones who explain the nature of pure devotion by philosophical texts and by philosophical words. But Arjuna didn't explain pure devotion by warriors' acts as Kshatriya's heroism. So, that's why Arjuna is not included. Of course, he is a representative of the parampara, but because of the specifics of his dharma, his akshatriya, he is defending by warrior's acts. But the parampara you're asking is the brahmanas, the acharyas, the theologists, based on preaching of Krishna consciousness, purity of sacred texts, sacred scriptures, so that they are handed over to the next generations without any deviations, without any changes. This is the answer I could give you.
Thank you.
We have another question. How to differentiate and how to define when we feel the compassion or when we feel the when we feel pity, how can we do it? How can we differentiate the two? It's a great question. How can we differentiate? Let's begin that we first take how we obtain the faith. What's the truthful empathy? It begins from with Shraddha.
Спасибо большое.
It's the experience.
и определять, когда мы испытываем
страдания, it's the seed of the soul, it's the seed of the heart,
правильно действовать в эти моменты,
the seed of our consciousness. So this experience, emotional experience that we see from the pure devotee, this pure devotee is the seed of our heart, and his drop of Krishna prema, a small drop, it falls down into our heart, and we feel such emotional experience of happiness, and it makes us happy, and we say, I'm not the body, I'm the servitor of Krishna. I have a lawful service to transcendental service. Krishna, I have this bliss, happiness, ecstasy, but not for long. It's only a drop, it's only a seed, it's not a tree yet. And our heart is covered with numerous arguments that Arjuna uses in chapter 1, and all these habits, all these customs, all this taste of material happiness. And what Rupa Goswami advises us, we strengthen our faith, our experience of spiritual sadhusanga, the communication, networking with the devotees, pure devotees. We, when we connect and when we interact with pure devotees, we strengthen our own faith, and the length of the bliss, being in bliss and Krishna consciousness will lengthen if we are, as much we are immersed in the sadhusanga. Ideally, it's the communication and networking, interacting with the pure devotees of Krishna and taking the instructions based on Shakti, Bhajana Kriya. Bhajana Priya helps us if we are strengthened into one, and helps us to define and differentiate between the empathy and pity, and Krishna and Bhagavad Gita, Abhideya Rupa Goswami, in the chapter 10 of Bhagavad Gita, explained. Сататам Виктана, those who are engaged in pure devotee service, Джата Пурвака, и Нама Паянтите, who is connected with the service in to pure devotees. It allows us to overcome our material consciousness. And in Shakti, there is this strength to differentiate between the spirit and the matter. And it happens all in the dynamic. In the dynamics. Bhajana Priya. You see, when we serve the pure devotees, here our intelligence will help us to differentiate from empathy from pity, and pity from empathy. And Prabhupada, as he said, if you see some wound, when you blow over the wound, but the wound is still bleeding, and it's infectious wound, infectious abscess, and the furuncle, and this infected wound is getting worse and worse, and we're not doing anything, we're just blowing air on it. But what we should do is we have to cut that abscess, cut that wound, cut this infectious abscess swell from the body. We cause the pain, but the intelligence says to us, we're doing a good thing because we're stopping this infection. stopping this, the growing of infectious swell. And if you depend on the spiritual master, if you're in transcendental service, Krishna will give you this amazing intelligence, and Krishna will give you the authority to become that surgeon, to cut out that swell. If you're not certain, if you're not sure, then you're not given that authority to conduct this operation. But maybe you will cause pain to this person. Maybe it will be unpleasant, but you will bring the benefit. You will bring the goodness. But if you're not sure, don't do that operation. But maybe with good word, you will advise. So the guna of grace, the guna of goodness, the guna of goodness will give you the authority to, for some, to cut out this infectious swell. But maybe if you're not authorized, maybe you should show at least the pity. But you will differentiate pity from empathy. But if such is our service, we will be able to help the person ultimately and finish finitely. So maybe we will be able to give people the Krishna gift. It's a very special operation. You have to be careful, and you have to have authority from Krishna. But I'd like to say that truthful empathy and true empathy, it doesn't come from us, it comes from Krishna. But false empathy could come from us. But we do not have truthful empathy, true, genuine empathy. It comes from Krishna. But if we feel that Krishna is demonstrating empathy through us, then we can manifest it. But on the level of Ahankara, we don't feel that this is Krishna that's speaking through us. Then we shouldn't do it. So if we conclude, if it's not a theoretical differentiation, first we should get the faith through listening, through marathons like that, through reading the books of Srila Prabhupada, through sadhu sangha, through communication with the devotees. And then we can feel that we can differentiate empathy to pity. Can we make it more precise? If our empathy is true or truthful or false, how can we differentiate this intelligence from Krishna coming from Krishna? You are now trying to hypothetically imagine it. We think that the intelligence can actually differentiate, and intelligence can maybe prevent us from some risks and set out some algorithms and behavioral patterns, but we should recognize intelligence will not help us. I mean, our mind is not help us. The mental platform is not help us. Will not help us. And Bhagavad Gita tells us that you should rise up to intelligence. It will come up on the chapter 3 when Krishna will explain the transcendental psychology and transcendental of the highest, the supreme, that the feelings are higher than the objects of the feelings and the intelligence are higher than the mind. So he will say, fool, fill your intelligence with the transcendental intelligence, transcendental knowledge. That's what we're trying to do right now. And intelligence will exactly allow us to get rid of expectations and our desire to get the scheme, get us a stereotype. It will not happen. So let's not get ahead of ourselves. So let's follow the process of the our devotional service. We come into satsanga, into communication with pure devotees. Let's correctly understand. So let's just get into the service and get into communication of service, into the devotional communication with the devotees. As there is a saying, the war will show the plan. So we should not deliberately try to predefine and forecast and plan. Let's just relax and focus on our sadhana, on our practice. Listen to Bhagavad Gita. Listen to the holy name. And the time will come and the intelligence will tell us. So the question is coming really from the mind. We understand. It's not a bad question. But let's leave that question without answer, without reply. We shouldn't grow our illusion. We shouldn't water our illusion. This is the trap. That when we get this understanding, it's an illusion of understanding, that we will think that it's all understandable. Let's not feed our mind with this ignorant food. We will not reject our mind, but we will turn on the process, we will listen, we will awaken the consciousness. If the consciousness is sleeping and intelligence is sleeping, then the time has not come up yet. So the mind should get satisfied with that answer. And if the mind doesn't know anything, then the time hasn't come up yet. As if the wise man said, I know that I don't know anything, but other people don't know even that. Thank you. I hope I haven't disappointed you. No, on the contrary, I understand that if it comes from the mind, So how, another question, so how a great question, for example, if
Я знаю, что ничего не знаю, но другие даже этого не знают. Это нормально. Спасибо.
Спасибо большое.
Ты никого не разочаровал?
Наоборот, как бы есть понимание, что разум, он выше ума, и все придет свое время. Спасибо вам большое. У нас есть вопрос от Анны.
The last question from
как
Anna,
нам обусловленным душам строить взаимоотношения с Верховной Личностью Бога в дружеской расе, подобно Арджуне? Привлекает именно эта раса? Пожалуйста, раскройте немного эту тему.
Очень хорошо, что вас привлекает.
Это неплохое желание. Но опять-таки, свое время, если мы хотим,
it's a great thing that you are attracted by this rasa. It's not a good desire, but each desire has its time. But if you want to feel that rasa, it's a very special intelligence, very special consciousness. It's not operating with the philosophy, but with the taste. It's not the philosophy that you should discern, but you should feel the taste. So the logic and the dialectics and philosophy will not help. So it's recommended to develop towards rasa from the level of nishtha. And nishtha is a very firm belief, very firm faith. So you have some anartha still left. Maybe 20%, anartha, maybe 25%. It doesn't matter how much still left. But already a minority. So thanks to that, the intelligence is becoming so strong. So even if anartha manifests, the spirit is already still quite strong. So in the context of rasa tattva, what you're asking about, the spiritual experience, spiritual emotion is differentiated from the material experience and material emotion. There is a material emotion and there is an emotion of the soul, spiritual emotion. Thanks with the contact with the spiritual energy. It's first of all is the holy name. Krishna comes as Namarupa
during Kali Yuga.
Krishna comes down as a
holy name.
Vishuddhena Hrishikesha. The contact with feeling and sensing Krishna.
You start feeling this emotion.
And this is the thread.
This is the leading thread.
To watch that rasa. Before nishtha, it's really useless to move in that direction because while the consciousness and intelligence are not stable, the anartha will have this ability to imitate. All the forces of material nature are based on imitation.
So,
and the material emotions will imitate the spiritual emotions, spiritual feelings, and the spiritual senses. And that's why we will be bewildered and we could be taken out of the right path. So how Shavarang Swami is saying, we do not base our conclusion on our feelings. It's not that we do not take them into account, but we do not believe them, we do not base our conclusions on our feelings. We do not believe our own feelings. It's before nishtha. After nishtha, our feelings are becoming the vehicles for transcendental knowledge, becoming the mechanism for transcendental. And in the sphere of self-awareness, we will differentiate the spiritual emotion. We will base our life, base our being, everything. How Chaitanya Chandracharan says, how a person carefully, gradually walking on the ice, he doesn't know if the ice is hard enough and strong enough. So, if the ice is thin, you can fall under the water, into the icy waters. So when anartha is manifest, very small one, some weakness, and a person can drown in material emotions. So it's a cheap imagination, cheap image of rasa. But if the eyes is hard enough, strong enough, then we go further. And after the nishtha, we go to rasa. And Rupa Goswami describes that. And Srila Prabhupada in the Nectar of Devotion, he describes that as well. So, namely, on the level of stable and
strong, intelligence and strong consciousness,
we take into account all everything, and we actually give ourselves a true account of whether we stand on the strong eyes or on the thin one. And we have to wait until the ice becomes thicker and it freezes up. And if we're not in Sangha, we're not defended with the active relationships with pure devotees. We should not give ourselves this estimation of, and we shouldn't ourselves give this assessment to ourselves whether we are on our qualification, whether we're standing on the thin ice or on the strong ice. I am on the level of nishtha or not on the level of nishtha. It's not us to give us this estimation, assessment. It should be given by the mirror, like in the mirror of a relationship with the devotees and most of all with the spiritual master. And as soon as the guru says to you, it's time, then we will get that instruction, we will not have any doubts, and the ice will let us to skate on it and be in the rasas, and everything will be unveiled to us. But before that, even us going in front of the deities of Radha and Govinda, like in Omsk, Radha Govinda, we should treat them in the spirit of Lakshmi Narayana, the spirit of respect, spirit of humility, and spirit of Sadhana Bhakti. And this is a beginning of the practice, and there is no talk about rasas yet. And Prabhupada warns us about it. He says that even before the deities of Radha Krishna, you should respect, in the spirit of respect, you should look at the deities and get in front of them in spirit of humility, and we should wait for this stability of the intelligence, stability of consciousness. Thank you so much. This is the time. So these are the last questions. Thank you for this amazing talk. Amazing lecture. Thank you to all the devotees. It's a great, 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 great blessings and bestowing of the grace.